Friends, today I am starting the third semester subject, Strength of Materials. The first unit in this subject is Simple Stress and Strain. Simple Stress and Strain. Now first let us see what is the meaning of stress and what is the meaning of strain. See, when we apply a force or what we call load on a body, the body reacts, it gives a reaction to that force or load, which is known as the stress. Stress is defined as, it is the internal reaction offered by a material to the external load applied on it. Now stress is directly proportional to the load. That means higher the load, higher will be the stress. Higher is the load, higher will be the stress, and it is inversely proportional to the area of the body, area of cross section of the body. That means greater is the area, lesser is the stress. Lesser is the area, greater is the stress. So mathematically it is the ratio of load to area of cross section. Area of cross section. So I can write it mathematically like this: stress is equal to load divided by area of cross section. Now we can give some symbols to this. So if F is the symbol of stress, P is the symbol of load, then A is the area of cross section. Now this relationship connects three quantities: stress, load and area of cross section. These are the three quantities connected by this relationship. If we know any two of them, out of these three, if we know any two, then the third one can be found out from here. Now the SI unit of stress is, load will be in Newton. Load is generally given in Newton. Area is generally in square millimeter. So SI unit of stress is Newton per mm square. Or it can also be called as mega Pascal. 1 Newton per mm square is same as 1 mega Pascal. So it can be given either in Newton per mm square or in mega Pascal. Both are same. So this is what we call the simple stress, the definition of simple stress and its mathematical formula. From this mathematical formula, we can get one quantity if we know the other two quantities. Now, types of simple stresses. Next. See, the type of stress, simple stress, depends upon the type of load which is applied on the body. Suppose I have a body like this. This is some body. Now, if a force is applied like this, if a load is applied like this, that is, I apply a load like this, I apply a load like this, this load, then the load is called as tensile load. This load is called as tensile load. If the load is tensile in nature, if the load applied is tensile in nature, then the stress induced in this body, stress developed in this body, is known as the tensile stress. So there are, this is one type of stress. One is tensile stress. Now the basic formula remains the same. It is the ratio of tensile load, divided by area of cross section, So this F, if I give a suffix T, then it becomes tensile. It represents tensile stress. So tensile load divided by area of cross section. Next, if the load is like this, if it is applied like this on the same body, if the load is applied like this, this is the nature of load, then the load is said to be a compressive load or crushing load. Then the stress that is induced in the body is called as compression stress or crushing stress. This will be equal to compressive load, again in newtons, divided by area of cross section. So FC, this will be PC divided by A. The third one is, if this is the body, this is the axis, if the load acts like this, then the load is called as shearing load. Approximately perpendicular to the axis, then it is called as shearing load. Then the stress that is developed in the body is called as shear stress. Shearing stress or shear stress will be equal to shearing load. Shearing means cutting. Shearing load divided by area of cross section. So it will be PFS, this will be denoted as FS, will be equal to PS divided by A. So basic formula remains the same, F is equal to P by A. This area is generally not given. They give us the dimension of the section. Depending if it is circular, they give the diameter. Then we have to find the area by using the formula pi d square by 4. If it is square, they give the side of the square, then area of cross section will be a square, side square. So like that. So these are the three types of simple stresses which are induced in a body subjected to simple loads: tensile, compressive and shearing loads. Next, so what is the meaning of strain? Strain. See, when a load is applied on a body, the body undergoes deformation. Deformation means there will be change in its dimensions. So the change in dimension of a body under load per unit dimension is what is called as strain. It is the deformation or change in dimension. Deformation is nothing but change in dimension of a is the deformation of a body under external load. External load per unit dimension. Per unit dimension. That means change in dimension per mm or per centimeter or per meter, like that. If it is linear, it is like that. It is the deformation of a body under external load per unit dimension. Now, mathematically, it is the ratio of change in dimension to its original dimension, and strain has no unit, because it is the ratio of change in dimension to original dimension. Both will be in the same unit, so it will not be having any dimension. Mathematically, strain is the ratio of change in dimension to original dimension, both in same units. Hence, it will have no unit. Strain has no unit. This is the definition of strain. Now, types of simple strain. Again, there are three types of simple strain. They are, the first one is called linear, or it is also called as longitudinal strain. Whenever we simply say strain, if nothing is told, it is said simply strain. It is this strain only. This is change in length. It is defined like this: change in length by original length, both in the same unit. Both can be in mm, both can be in centimeter, or both can be in meter. Now, if we give symbols, this is small e is equal to change in length delta L divided by L. Change in length is delta L divided by small l. Second one is lateral strain means it is the ratio of change in lateral dimension. See, this is the linear dimension, this is the lateral dimension. This is linear, this is lateral. If I keep the body like this and apply a load like this, this is linear dimension, this is lateral dimension. So, change in lateral dimension by original lateral dimension now this is e small e with suffix l is equal to change in lateral dimension, means if the body is circular, if it is circular, change in dimension will be change in dia divided by original dia. If it is square, then lateral dimension will be delta A, change in the dimension of the side of the square divided by original side. If it is rectangular, delta B by B, delta T by T, it depends upon the shape, the cross section. It can be either circular, it can be square, it can be rectangular. These are the normally occurring shapes, cross sections that we get. So it depends upon that. Then you have what we call the volumetric strain. Third one is the volumetric strain. This will be change in volume divided by original volume of the body. This is EV is equal to delta V by V, change in volume. Here also, for any strain there is no unit, because both numerator and denominator will be in the same unit, hence they will not have any unit. Now for a circular body, body of circular cross section, these three are connected by the relationship. EV is equal to E minus 2 times lateral strain, linear strain minus 2 times lateral strain. This relationship can also be used. Whenever we know any two of these, the third one can be found out from this. The volumetric strain is equal to linear strain minus lateral strain. See, when we apply a load on a body, there are all the changes will be there. There will be change in length, there will be change in diameter, there will be change in volume. All the three will be there together. Next comes the definition of Poisson's ratio. Poisson's ratio. See, when we apply an external load on a body, simultaneously there will be both linear as well as lateral strain. Now, the ratio of lateral strain to linear strain in a body subjected to external load is known as the Poisson's ratio. It is the ratio of lateral strain to linear strain, ratio of lateral strain to linear strain in a body subjected to external load. Whenever there is an external load on a body, the body simultaneously undergoes both linear strain as well as lateral strain. There will be linear strain also, there will be lateral strain also. The ratio of lateral strain to linear strain is what we call the Poisson's ratio. This doesn't have a unit, that also doesn't have a unit. Strain has no unit, so Poisson's ratio also will not have any unit. It is denoted by 1 by m or mu, and it has no unit. This also doesn't have any unit. Mathematically Poisson's ratio is equal to ratio of lateral strain to linear strain. Again, here 1 by m is equal to EL divided by A. It connects three quantities, If we know any two of them, the third one can be found out. So this is the definition of Poisson's ratio. Next we move to Hooke's law. Hooke's law. This law states that within elastic limit, the stress in a body is directly proportional to the strain. Simply strain means it is the linear strain. Always if we say simply strain, it is linear or longitudinal strain. Now what it means is when the body is elastic, that is it's a property. Elasticity is a mechanical property of a material. Now what it says is, suppose we put a force, it gets extended. If you remove that force, it comes back to its original size and dimension. Then you say it is elastic. The material is elastic. So within that elastic limit, the stress in a body is directly proportional to the strain. That means they are directly proportional, means if stress increases, strain also increases. If stress decreases, strain also decreases. Such a relationship between any two quantities is known as directly proportional. Now you have this mechanical testing lab, it's a practical subject. There you conduct a test, we conduct a number of tests. One of the tests that we conduct is the tensile test is conducted on a specimen. After conducting that tensile test, what we do is we draw a graph between load. We take load generally on the vertical axis, or this is nothing but stress, because the load is directly proportional to stress. Here we take elongation, that is increase in length. Elongation is taken here, and this is directly proportional to strain. So this graph, though we draw it between load and elongation, it is similar to drawing the graph between stress and strain. This diagram that we get, this graph that we get, is known as the stress strain diagram. Always when we conduct a tensile test, usually we draw this diagram. This is called as stress strain diagram or load versus elongation diagram. If we do it, what we get is, the graph that we get will be something like this. This is the graph that you get. This graph is known as the stress strain diagram. For normally mild steel, etc., this is the how the diagram will come. Now here, when the load is this much or the stress is this much, this is the corresponding strain, this is the corresponding elongation. Now if I release this load, suppose I have loaded up to here, this is the corresponding elongation, and now if I release this load, if I make this load zero, what happens is this will also become zero. Whatever elongation has taken place, that will come back to zero. Then we say that the material is elastic. Up to this point, the material is elastic. That is, it has that property of regaining its original dimension once the load is released. Once it reaches this point is called as the yield point. Yield point. The load here is called as the yield load. and the stress at that point is called as the yield stress. That is, the material has yielded, it has surrendered, it cannot fight, it can no longer fight. Then it enters into the plastic state. Here it is plastic. That is, plasticity is a property where the deformation, whatever changes that have taken place, that is, suppose I have stressed it up to here, this is the corresponding strain. Now if I release this load, this will not come back. It will retain its deformed condition. It will be in plastic state. Then we say it is in plastic state. Now this stress here is called as the maximum stress or the ultimate stress. This is the ultimate stress. Then it will break here, somewhere here it will break. So this diagram is known as the stress strain diagram. Now mathematically what happens is, mathematically if you write this law, stress is directly proportional. This is called the sign of proportionality. So stress is proportional to linear strain. This is how it is written. Or if I use mathematical symbols, I have used F as the symbol for stress, E as the symbol for strain. This will be what we get. Next, if I want to change this sign of proportionality to sign of equality, I can do it. I can change it. But what I have to do is, here a constant is to be introduced. Here this E is the constant of proportionality, constant, it is called constant of proportionality, or it is known as the Young's modulus. It is called the Young's modulus, Young's, Young's modulus, or it is also called as modulus of elasticity, modulus of elasticity. This is a property of a material. Property of a material. This E is called the constant of proportionality, and this mathematically E will be equal to stress by strain. This E, if you transfer this side, F by E will be equal to capital E. Its unit is Newton per mm square, because stress, unit of stress is Newton per mm square, and this strain doesn't have any unit. So the unit of Young's modulus will be Newton per mm square. So this is what Hooke's law states. They can ask it as state Hooke's law, or they can ask define modulus of elasticity or Young's modulus. The answer remains the same. They can also ask you to draw this diagram and mark these points. Here it is elastic, this is the yield point, the stress corresponding to this load is the yield stress. The stress corresponding to this is ultimate stress. The stress corresponding to this point is called as the breaking stress. So like this, these can be asked. In theory, they can ask these things. You must be prepared to write those things. I hope you have understood this clearly. You have got the idea clearly here. Next, factor of safety. Factor of safety. See, generally when we are designing some machine part, the working stress will be somewhere here. This is called the working stress, or the allowable stress, permissible stress, design stress, whatever you call that, that will be the somewhere here, much below the yield point, much below the yield stress or the ultimate stress. So this factor of safety is defined as a ratio of, factor of safety is the ratio of yield stress to working stress. Working stress, design stress, allowable stress, they are all one and the same. So this one, this will be a number, it will be a number. because both will be in the same unit here. This is also stress, this is also stress, both will be in the same unit, so it will be a number. Its value generally will be between 2 to 4 if it is yield stress. If it is ultimate stress or maximum stress, then the value of factor of safety will be between 4 to 8. This is factor of safety also can be given as ultimate stress by working stress. Now the factor of safety that is assumed will be generally between 4 to 8. Minimum is 4, maximum is 8. That means this will be 1/4 to 1/8 of this stress. This will be 1/4 to 1/8 of this stress, or half to 1/4 of this stress. That will be called as the working stress. We never go even very close to this. So this is factor of safety. Sometimes what they do in a problem, what they do is, instead of giving the working stress or allowable stress, they give yield stress or ultimate stress. Then you have to assume the factor of safety. If it is not given, or if they will give that factor of safety, you will have to divide it by factor of safety to get the working stress. For that purpose, you should know this. Then, apart from the Young's modulus or modulus of elasticity I described just now, there are two other moduli or elastic properties. Now.